Welcome to church, and thanks for joining us. Service will begin soon. While we are preparing, let's try some Bible trivia.
Well, good morning. Praise the Lord. Welcome to Joy and Praise Fellowship. People are making their way through the doors even as I speak. It's good to be here this morning. You know what? Why don't we start off by giving the Lord a good hand clap of praise today? Hallelujah. It's so good to be here in God's house. Just today we have you're going to be hearing in a little bit our guest speaker, Brian Norman, from the Early Earth Educators. He's our speaker today and did a fantastic job at the 8:30 service. Really going to educate you on some things that you're just not going to believe. But God is good, and we're going to have a good time of praise and worship, and we're just going to have a great service today. But before we get started with this, before we pray, I like Nathaniel Roberts to come up here. Come here, Nathaniel. Come here. Come here a minute. Come here a minute. You know, we always talk about training up our kids, right, in the ways of the Lord, where they won't depart when they grow up. Well, this young man plays basketball. I have a lot of these basketball leagues in town. They're straight up, you know, upper sports and different type of sports stuff they have up here. Well, he was showing me this morning. He got an award given to him this year from Straight Up Sports. And guess what the award says? Most Christ-like. That's the award. That's the kind of award you want right there, most Christ-like. So out of all the guys and girls, whatever, the co-ed or whatever's on their team, he got that award for being most Christ-like. So he's showing Christ-like out there with his friends and his peers. He's not just keeping it here in the doors. He's taking it outside these walls. And Nathaniel, we are very, very proud of you, son. I want to brag about him a little bit, because that's what it's all about right there. Being Christ-like out there to your schools and your peers and everybody else. Today we're going to ask you to stand to your feet today. We're going to pray over the service, but we're also going to pray over Israel today. Unless you were on vacation to Mars or something and didn't know what was going on, there's a conflict there again. Palestinians and Israel and Hamas and all that. We have another one of these conflicts that's getting worse by the minute. They're talking about a war now. It's just happening, and it's not good. And I don't know how our government thinks, but I know that we still support Israel. And the Bible said that if we bless Israel, we'll be blessed. So we do pray for Israel. We know that a lot of them still don't serve Jesus. We know that. They haven't accepted him as Lord, Savior, and Messiah yet. There are a lot of Messianic Jews that have, but it isn't for us to judge, you know. We know that what the Bible says, that they will come around. And that I believe it's 144,000 will be enlightened into the fact of Jesus Christ as Lord, Savior, and Messiah. And that remnant will be saved of Israel. But right now, they need our prayers. America needs our prayers. They need our prayers. The world needs our prayers. So today, we're here in a beacon of freedom here called Florida. Florida's still the closest beacon of freedom we have in America today. But we're in a beacon of freedom here called Florida. We're able to worship God. We're able to praise God. And we're going to have a good service today. But remind you of this, though, as we're having this peaceful, wonderful, loving service, there are little children over there in Israel now going to school wondering if they're going to come home alive. Civilians being killed by missiles and bombs right now as we speak. Our kids don't have to face such a thing, but they do. So let's pray for them this morning. Father, in Jesus' name, we pray, God, for Israel today. We pray for the citizens of Israel and Palestine and the whole region. God, there are many on both sides of the aisle that are very innocent, good people, God. Unfortunately, God, there's a lot of evil souls that are just causing havoc, all for personal gain. God, we pray in Jesus' name for the peace of Jerusalem, God, and for Israel, God, and for you to preserve your people. To put a hedge of protection around them, keep them safe from their enemies, God. Cause a truce, a peace to happen there, God, a ceasefire, if you will, God, in the name of Jesus. We pray also for America, God, that you will bless our president, God, and bless all those in our government, God. Give them the wisdom and knowledge from heaven, God, today to govern this nation. We also pray, God, even though we know that good things are happening as far as this virus is concerned, we're also well aware that it's not totally gone yet. But God, today in Jesus' name, by the authority of Jesus, I cast it back to the pits of Hades. I cancel this assignment right now. I declare it defeated right now in the name of Jesus. so that all masks can come off, God, so all social distancing can go away, God, not just those that have been vaccinated. God, I pray in the name of Jesus, you would cancel that virus right now in Jesus' name. And I pray, dear God, for those poor children on the border, God, that are coming through, God, by themselves even, 5 and 6-year-olds, God, we pray for their safety today. We pray, God, that you would watch over them and keep them safe from evildoers. And God, I pray right now for this service, that you'd bless this service, that you would cause our praise to turn into worship, and our worship, God, to call it the glory of God to encompass this place, God. I pray blessing upon our speaker who's going to speak to us today. Give him wisdom from heaven. And give us the ears to hear what the Spirit would say to the church today, God. And I pray, God, that when we leave here today, God, may we leave here not only encouraged, God, but also equipped, God, to represent you well in the earth. Bless your people. Bless this service. Bless those that are at home viewing this via the stream. May you, God, receive all glory, honor, and praise due to your name. For we praise you, God, this morning in Jesus' name. Amen.
How many of y'all know we're a work in progress, that God's molding and shaping our lives every day? Amen? Let's praise him today.
I'm on the road to recovery. I'm on the road. I feel
If you've got something holding you back, God is breaking every single chain, not just one, every single one. And you know what? What did Paul and Silas do when they were in prison, when they were in chains and bondage? They praised him. So that's what we need to do. When you've got bondage, when you've got stuff holding you back, that's what you do. You need to praise him. Hallelujah.
In prisoner's chains, with bleeding stripes, Paul and Silas prayed that night, and in their pain began to sing.
And this is what happened.
Bless your name. I bless.
chains that need to be loosened this morning, just reach out. Just reach out and ask God to loosen those chains. Just praise Him. Praise Him, and those chains will fall off in the name of Jesus. Be free in Jesus. Father God, we lift up your name because we know that you are bigger than any problems that's going on in our nation today. You are larger than life, Father God. You are Father Creator. You created every human being in your image, Father God. And you are so great that we can't even comprehend how great you truly are. We lift up our hands and worship you, our Creator, our Father.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart. Great are you, Lord.
lift your hands up.
Father, we praise you, God, today.
We thank you, dear God, for being a people that acknowledge you today, God. Reward us, God, for our obedience unto you. Bless this service. Bless your people, God. And may the praises of God always be in our lips, we pray. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Won't you greet somebody in the Lord today? Won't you wave at someone? Won't you fist pump someone? Won't you thank someone for being here? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, praise the Lord. Welcome to Joy and Praise Fellowship. At this time, well, we'll dismiss our kids to service. Kids, Pastor Clint's going to take care of today. Miss Amanda's mom, Dolly's in the hospital, so she's away from us today. Keep Dolly in your prayers today as she's in the hospital. Also, keep Brother Ron Morgan in your prayer today. Ron Morgan going to be having a procedure tomorrow. May have to have a heart procedure pretty soon, so keep Ron Morgan in your prayers as well. Brother Ron and Sister Dolly, both in your prayers this morning. Nancy still, she's still going through her battle. Nancy DeMarco and George, keep them in your prayer to the Marcos. And Mr. Norman, keep Norman in your, Mitch. This morning we are blessed because we have all of you here, but Miss Jones here, 14 months she's been away. She's back with us after 14 months. That's Norman's sister. She said, I've been faithful. I've been watching all on the stream for all this time, but it's so good to be here, right? Praise the Lord, Joan. It's good to have you here. You know, I meet with other pastors often in this community, this demographic here specifically. We have prayer and stuff. And they were telling me the other day, they were saying, man, I don't know what you guys are doing down there. Your parking lot is full with cars every week compared to us. And I said, well, to me, it's quite simple. You know, Jesus said if he be lifted up, he'll draw all men to himself. So we're lifting up the Lord. We're being obedient to the word. We're not a perfect people. We're being obedient. But one thing we do, man, we will praise him. We will praise him. We are unashamed. We will praise Jesus. And if we keep praising him like that, I tell you what's going to happen, folks. Remember in the story in the Word of God when they dedicated the temple? They said the glory of God was so powerful in that temple that the priest couldn't even come in. Means, in this sense, Pastor Eddie would be out there. And the glory of God would be in here. Really doing a work beyond anything me or the guest speaker could ever do for you today. But keep praising him. Keep worshiping him. Keep being obedient to the word. You know, God doesn't want sacrifices. He wants obedience. Okay, there's no pleasure. There's no pleasure in sacrifices. Okay. Sacrifices. Oh, well, you're just lucky I'm here today, preacher. That's a sacrifice. You know, there's no blessing in that. I'm not lucky for that. I don't want you to be here out of forcing yourself to be here. But boy, if you're an on-fire, Holy Spirit-led person of God that's here in obedience, then you are a blessing to me in the church. Hallelujah. Do we have any first-time guests today? If you're a first-time guest, never been here before, just raise your hand. We want to give you a nice hand clap today. We got a couple of them right here. Quite a bit of them. Keep them up. Keep them up. Well, we're going to give you something. Over here, Luke. We got three here, one here, two over there. We got a gift for you. We're going to give you before you leave today. And we also have a card for you to fill out, please. We won't solicit your information, we promise. We just want to know a little bit about you. That way we can mail you things in the mail about our church. And if you are looking for your home church or a church to call your home church, we'd like you to really strongly consider Joy and Praise Fellowship. You know, there's a lot of great churches in the area, but I believe there's always that perfect church for you. You know, there's got to be that perfect church just for you. There's a lot of great churches I could pastor, but this is where God has me pastoring. Same way with you. There's a lot of great churches you can attend, but you got to find the one for you. And we pray that this is the one for you. And if it is, we ask you to keep coming, be part of our ministry, part of our church family, grow in our church with us, and God will get you involved in some great things in the future. Before we take up the offering this morning, though, we're going to go over a few announcements real quick. We do have a membership class that we've been advertising. It's going to be on Monday night, June 7th, 7 p.m. If you have been here more than three months or more, and you have Jesus living in your heart, we would love for you to consider being a voting member of this church. We would love you to come, be a part of that class. It's about an hour and 15-minute class. I can share with you, I'm going to be sharing with you about the 16 fundamental truths of the Assemblies of God and the basic, you know, what we believe in here at this church. And if our ideologies line up with your ideologies, then we'll bring you into membership, okay? We have a sign-up sheet out there in the foyer. If you'd like to be a part of that, just sign up and be a part of it. Also, this is the month of May is a five-Sunday month. Every time we have a month that has five Sundays in it, what we do at the last Sunday of the month, we take up an additional seed offering for our new building project. For those that are new to us here, we're going to be building on an addition to this church, a new fellowship hall, youth center, behind the playground there. It's a 5,000 square foot building that we'll be able to have a lot of more ministries in that building. And that's how we were able to build this building. We were in a storefront facility for years. We were taking up fifth Sunday offerings and things of that nature, and we raised the money to build this church here, and we're going to do the same thing for that building there. The only reason why we haven't even come close to breaking ground is because, I don't know if you know about the economy right now, the cost of building supplies are going through the roof. So they're advising us to keep raising your money, raise your funds, so that way when the costs come back down a little bit, it'd be more feasible for us to build it at an economical cost. You know, we're put to be good stewards, right? So let's do it the right way. So keep the money coming in. Pray about what you can give on that fifth Sunday. Remind you of this, that fifth Sunday offering does not take the place of your tithes and offerings. It is an additional seed offering. And speaking about that, let me tell you something. I don't know where you stand on tithes. I've been tithing since I got saved. And I will tell you this. God's always been faithful to me and my family, and He'll be faithful to you. Understand this. The first 10% we owe, anything above that we sow. You want a real blessing? Sow above the 10%, and God will pour it into your laps. We also have youth group tonight, 5 o'clock, and prayer tomorrow night at 6 o'clock. I really believe that 6 o'clock Monday prayer is what's really fueling the engine of this church. That Monday night prayer is throwing logs in the fire, praying for the service and praying for the church, praying for you. We could always use more. We could always have more. It was in that service just this past Monday night that I was there where Brother Wayne said something that was very profound. That I'll tell you, Wayne, it stuck with me ever since. And I shared it with some of y'all on Wednesday. Wayne said the Lord shared with him, laid in his heart, that this church here is a warship, not a cruise ship. A warship, not a cruise ship. The foyer not called the Lido deck. We don't have that kind of entertainment here. There's some churches that like to entertain you, you know, like to tickle your ears. We're not one of them churches. We're a passionate church. We're war against the enemy. We don't war against ourselves. The kitchen gets a little hot sometimes in our services. The topics can get hot. The worship can get hot. You just say, if it's too hot in the kitchen, you got to get out. Don't get out. Get in. Get in. Don't get out. Get in and be a part of what God is doing here. Also, for those of you that have been donating items to the nursery, toys, strollers, things of that nature, don't bring nothing else. We have so many items, we can't even walk back there. We lost a kid looking for him around the toys. Where's the kid at? Don't bring any more toys or items to the nursery for a while. We thank you for what you give, but no more. Also, one more announcement is, after the service today, back in the children's area, you got two things you're going to do after service. The first thing you're going to do is you're going to stop by Brian Norman's booth out there, his table. You're going to buy a bunch of resources. You're going to shake his hand and thank him for the great job he's doing today. But after you leave there, go back into the children's area. We have an auction going on there, a silent auction. We have items we want you to make a bid on. All proceeds of that auction go to the new building, okay? So you're actually giving to yourselves, in a sense, by giving to that new building. Go back there, buy something, give it to your wife. It'll make the rest of your day good, guys, okay? Do that after service today. So with that being said, let's go ahead and prepare our hearts for the offering this morning unto the Lord, and we'll just pray over it at this time. Father God, in Jesus' name, we pray, God, that you'd bless the offering. As we give it, God, may you multiply it, God. May your kingdom advance because of it, and may you meet the needs in our lives. We pray this morning, God, in Jesus' name, amen. We'll start over here. Just work your way across on this side and this side as well. We have two guys down here. I want you to know this morning that we're going to give Brother Norman a check on behalf of the church. But if the Lord laid on your heart at the end of this service to put a little something extra in his pocket, please do so. Person, man is worthy of his hire. Amen. All right, God bless you.
All of creation, all of the earth, make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Wake up the saint, let every nation shout of your fame, yeah.
Praise the Lord. Thank you for your giving. About a year ago, was it about a year ago, brother, you were here? Before the pandemic started? 19, right before the pandemic started. Brian Norman and his wife came to us, and they're from the Early Earth Educators. He'll tell you more about his bio in a minute, but he's a theologian, she's a scientist, and they come together. And they work as a hand in a glove in their ministry, and they're able to support the Bible with science. A lot of people say that can't be possible. It is. They make it possible. And he's got tons of literature out there and tons of different ministries and topics that he has spoken on across. He's getting a lot of popularity. Matter of fact, a gentleman here that I know said to me that, yeah, I thought I saw him somewhere in this area already not long ago. So God's using you in a mighty way, Brian. To get the word out. But today he comes to us, and he's going to be speaking to us about a very, very important topic, one that's been front and center for weeks and months on our TV screens. So why don't we give him a nice joy and praise welcome to Brian Norman.
Good morning, everybody. And thank you to the praise team for making worship so good and so easy to worship here. Let's thank our praise team one more time. Love it. I have the privilege of coming here on more than one occasion, and I always get to enjoy the presence of God here. So thank you so much. As Pastor said, I'm Brian. My wife and I run a ministry called Early Earth Educators. That's her and me. I'm the goofy one on the left. She's the pretty one on the right. And our bottom line is that the Bible and science agree. Not just some of the time, not just most of the time, all the time, the Bible and science agree. Because God is the God of the Scriptures, and He's also the God of creation. When we're studying science, all we're really doing is studying God's creation. Whether we're looking through a telescope or a microscope, we're just studying what God has made. And that's a good thing. It's not a bad thing. Shouldn't it be a scary thing? If science is done the right way, if we actually understand what science is and isn't, we will understand that the Bible and science always agree, because God doesn't lie, He doesn't make mistakes, and He never contradicts Himself. So whether we're studying scriptures or whether we're studying astronomy, we are studying something that's from God, and God never disagrees with Himself. So we want everybody to understand that. Bottom line, we want the lost to be saved. We want to evangelize the lost. We want to encourage the laity, people like yourselves who love God, love His word, but might be a little bit confused about some things that you've heard from society, maybe in public schools, maybe in a National Geographic TV show, maybe from some scientist who sounded really smart on TV who said some things that made you think that the Bible and science disagree. Well, they don't disagree. And that's what we're here to teach. We also want to equip leaders like Pastor Eddie with resources and information so he can lead his flock even better than he's already doing. And above all else, we want to exalt the Lord. That is what we do in our ministry. At Early Earth Educators, we do those things. Now, my master's degree is in theology. I'm a Bible nerd. My wife's degree, my wife also has a master's degree in science, so she is a science nerd. And together, as a harmoniously married couple, we believe that the Bible and science are also harmoniously married, that there is no contradiction between them. So a theologian and a scientist can be in perfect unity, not only in marriage, but in our beliefs as well. We both believe the same things. There is no conflict there. I'm a Christian, husband, father, teacher, author. My books are on the back table in the foyer. and a theologian. My wife is also a Christian, a wife, a mother, also a teacher. She has taught chemistry, physics, biology, anatomy and physiology, geology, which is her specialty. She has a master's degree in geology. She actually wrote her master's thesis on, get this, potassium-argon radiometric isotopic dating. I can barely say it, let alone know what it actually means. But basically, she dated the ages of rocks, okay? And she can tell you, she's not here today, sadly, but we do have some resources back there that can talk, that demonstrate, that talk about carbon dating, radiometric dating, and how there's a whole lot of assumptions that go into that, how they really don't know how old those rocks are, okay? If you ask her how old the Earth is, she would say about 6,000 years. And she's a geologist. She's actually done that stuff. She is, like I said, a scientist. And now I'm not a scientist, but I love science. You know how much I love science? Ask me how much I love science. Glad you asked. I love science so much I married a scientist. And she's a tremendous asset to the ministry. Unfortunately, she's not here today. Hopefully, she will be again. Oh, by the way, we have kids. last time I checked, we have 9. That's first commandment God ever gave to a human being was what? Be fruitful and multiply. There you go. So, we have indeed multiplied. However, if you look at our kids, you'll notice that some of them look a little bit different than the others. And by the way, the topic of today's message is the simple one-sentence solution to all racial tension. The simple one-sentence solution to all racial tension. I know, it's a very audacious, very grandiose, very arrogant title. But by the end of this message, you will know the simple one-sentence solution to all racial tension. It's biblical, it's scientific, it's practical. I'll give it to you later. Just as an intro. Okay, that was the hook. Now, back to the kids. As you'll notice, some of these kids look a little bit different than the others. Actually, they all look different because they're all different people. Sometimes people look at the picture and they say, hey, are some of your kids adopted? I say, how'd you guess? Yeah, in fact, the white guys who look just like me, they're adopted. No, I'm kidding. They're not the ones who are adopted. Obviously, the ones with darker skin are adopted. Now, you can probably make that guess just by looking at the picture. However, I noticed something interesting as I compared things closer. None of us have the same skin tone. None of us. 11 people, 11 different skin tones. So I'm like, that's interesting because, huh. Because when people talk about race, you know, they look at our family and think, oh, you're a mixed race family. There's 2 different races in your family. I'm like, well, 2? Looks like there's maybe 11. So I got a little bit confused about this, and this is one of the things that prompted me to really investigate this topic, and I wanted to find out, you know, what the solution to racial tension was. And I'm like, well, wait a minute now. If there's only just a couple of different races, 2, 3, 4 races, or whatever they say there are, why do we all have different skin tones? So, you know, like I said, I love science. I like scientific experiments. So I thought, you know what? I need to find out from some other people. I need to get a bigger sampling. Would you guys help me with that a little bit? Great. I have some money here, so I'll pay you for your research. I have a $20 bill here and another $20 bill here. I still am having trouble finding the answer to my question. I would like to find 2 people with the exact same skin tone. So we have a room of about 100 people here, it looks like. So if 2 people, the first 2 people who can come forward and show me that they both have the exact, and I mean exact, same skin tone, $20 to one of you, $20 to the others, slightly bigger crowd. So we'll give you 90 seconds. Now, it's bad enough to lose $20. I sure don't want to lose $40, so I'm going to try and find somebody to match my skin tone. So we got 90 seconds. You can walk around. You can participate. The first 2 people, same skin tone, show me. Ready, set, 90 seconds. Go. No. You can move around. All right, this is not going well so far. My experiment's not working. 60 seconds. I thought we might have that one too. I was thinking. I was close.
One flesh, does that count?
One flesh, yes, but not the same skin tone. Oh, this is not going well. We're half our time is gone. I got to get out in the sun more. No, I was hoping. You too? No, okay. This is all right. 30 seconds. Anybody? Too dark. What is going on here? This is not working. Anybody? 10.
Wait.
9, 8, 7, 6, nobody? 5, oh wait, here, okay, 4, I'm too red, 3, 2, 1. I guess I get to keep my money. I was pretty confident. However, I did lose money once. I've done this for hundreds of people now. Identical twins took my money. It happened. It was at a youth group. It's like, yeah, you got me. Okay. But isn't that something? Hundreds of people. And the only time I could find identical skin tones were with identical twins. Same mom, same dad, same womb at the same time. They got me, but nobody else. So what's with that? Because when you listen to people in the media talking about race, there's usually two races or three races they're talking about, right? If they're using the scientific terms, it's the Caucasian race, the Negroid race, the Australoid race from Australia, right? They talk about these different races, and they combine it with skin tone, and it's like it's not adding up to me. So I was really kind of confused about this topic. So, well, if we want to find the real answer to the question, where's the best place to first look? The Word of God, right? That's where we should look, right here in the Word of God. Because since this is such an important topic, since everybody's affected by it, since you can't turn on the news for half a day without hearing or seeing something about it, surely God would address it, right? It's an important topic. He cares about us. He gives us all the answers to the important topics. So obviously he's going to talk about race. Let's see what God says. So let's go to the Bible and see what God says about race. So I went to the King James translation first. How many verses do you think I found about race in the King James translation? Any guesses? How did you know that? Zero is exactly right. Now, I'm not talking about the word like running a race, like Paul ran the race, you know, finishing the course. Not a foot race, but skin tone race. The word is not there. Wow, that was back in 1611. That's a 400-year-old translation. Maybe they addressed it, but with the word that I don't know about, so maybe I'm not looking up the right word, so I'm like, okay, you know, I'll just go to a new translation. So I went to the New King James. Hey, one verse. It says, a mixed race shall settle in Ashdod, and I will cut off the pride of the Philistines. What is that talking about, a mixed race? Well, there's a footnote. What does the footnote say? That's in Zechariah 9:6, and the footnote says what? An illegitimate one. In other words, an offspring child from, you know, offspring of non-married parents. They probably could have chosen a better word than race. I think that was one of those tricky Hebrew words only used once or twice in Scripture, but that's really the meaning of the word best they can tell. So it's not what we're talking about here. Okay, well, let's go to a different translation. King James and New King James are striking out. Okay, well, the New American Standard, that's a translation that is used by a lot of Bible scholars. It's very literal. It sticks very close to the Hebrew and the Greek. Let's see what it says here. There's six verses, one we just read in Zechariah. Let's go to Ezra. What does it say about race? It says, for they have taken some of their daughters as wives for themselves and for their sons, so that the holy race has intermingled with the peoples of the land. So it's the last section there of Ezra. If you know what's going on there, the Jews had just come back from captivity. They were resettling in the land, and the believers, the Jews, were intermarrying with, you remember, non-believers, or intermarrying with the Gentiles. They're doing exactly what God said not to do. You're not supposed to intermarry with non-believers. Jews are supposed to marry Jews. Principle still true today, believers are only supposed to marry believers. If a believer marries a non-believer, there's a pretty scary chance one or more of your children will become non-believers. That principle still applies. Only marry a believer. They weren't doing that. That's what God was talking about right there when he said the holy race. In other words, the Jewish people. They could have just said that. It's not race in the way we think of it. Okay, there's some more verses, though. So seed is also the translation, the holy seed. We're intermarrying with people who are not believers. Okay, next one. We read Zechariah, read Ezra, now Mark. Mark 7:26 says, now the woman was a Gentile of the Syrophoenician race. Okay, so the translators chose the word race. The Greek word is genos. It's right up there on the screen. So you see the Greek word genos, the English pronunciation of it. What words do we get from genos in English? Family, offspring, generation. You can see the cognate right there. People. So we could have just said she was of the Syrophoenician people. She was of the Italian people. She was of the Puerto Rican people, right? That's what it means. That was her nationality. She was of that country. Okay, so not what we're looking for. We're looking for race, not nationality here. So we keep looking. It was he. Next verse is in Acts 7:19. This is Stephen talking. Stephen preaching just before they threw stones and martyred him. It was he who took shrewd advantage of our race. Again, this is Stephen, a Jew, speaking. And mistreated our fathers so that they would expose their infants and they would not survive. Talking about what happened in Exodus, when the people of Israel were slaves of the Egyptians. Took shrewd advantage of our race. Who's he talking about? The Jews. And that same word, by the way, genos, is used right there in that. So again, we're talking the Jewish people. It would be probably, a better, more clear translation. It's not talking about skin tone at all. Here's another one, the same word, genos. But you are a chosen race, or a chosen, what else could it say about us? You're a chosen generation, you're a chosen people, you're a chosen offspring. It's talking about us, by the way, believers in that passage in 1 Peter. A royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession. That's who you are. But just again, the word people is really better. It's not talking about skin tones, because everybody who's in that family of God qualifies, right? We're all in that one race of God's people, in other words. So that was it. That exhausts it for the NASB. No, nothing else that talks about race. Not giving me what I'm looking for. So I tried one more translation, the NIV, and it has 8 verses, 2 of which you've already read. The Ezra passage there, and I guess one of which we already read. But how about the Romans passage right here? Romans 9:3 says, Paul speaking here, "For I could wish that I myself were cursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my people, those of my own race." That word can be translated as what else? Kinsmen. Paul was deeply troubled that his fellow Jews, many of them, most of them, were not accepting Jesus the Messiah, the long-awaited Jewish Messiah, Jesus. Paul realized who he was, and some other Jews were, but most Jews were rejecting the message. They were trying to kill Paul for even sharing the message. He was deeply troubled in his heart about that. So much so, check out what he's saying. He's wishing, he said, you know, "I'll go to hell in place of my Jewish people. I want them so badly to get saved." That's basically what he's saying there. He was longing for his own kinsmen, the Jews, to receive Jesus, the Messiah. He was talking about the Jews, not whites and blacks and yellows and this and that. He was talking about Jewish people. Okay, so still not what we're trying to get here. Okay, whoa, here's something different. Genesis 6:5. Now we're getting somewhere. The Lord, help me out with this. You read the white part. "The Lord saw how great the wickedness of had become on the earth." Okay. Here's another one, 2 verses later. God's still speaking. "I will wipe from the face of the earth I have created." We read the Ezra passage, Job 28:28. "And he said to the fear of the Lord, that is wisdom." Psalm 12:1. "No one is faithful anymore. Those who are loyal have vanished from." Psalm 12:8. "Who freely strut about when what is vile is honored by." One last verse on race in the Bible. Here it is, Ecclesiastes 3:10. "I have seen the burden God has laid on." And that is what the Bible says about race. How many times did it call us white? 0. How many times did it call us black? Yellow, red, finish the song. Red and yellow, black and white. How sweet. But is it biblical? Now, please understand, I know people have good intentions. I know people have good intentions. When we teach those songs to Sunday school kids, we're doing it to be non-racist. I know that. I know that. I know that, I know that. We don't want to be racist. Hardly anybody I know wants to be racist. But that song, red and yellow, black and white, is that in God's word? I think those are man's words. Well-intentioned, maybe, but I don't believe those are God's words. I think those are man's words. I just say that because we need to be careful to make sure, especially on this topic, that we don't adopt man's way of thinking. And I think that's what we, the church, have done far too long. We have adopted a non-biblical way of thinking about race. We've even integrated it into the church with examples like that song. So, how about they are learning about him? How about instead of red, yellow, black, and white, they are learning about him, let us pray they'll let Christ in. Something like that. Maybe something that just we can teach kids without dividing us in unnecessary ways, because I don't see any of that red, yellow, white, and black stuff in the scriptures. So if the Bible says that we're one race, the human race, well, our ministry teaches that the Bible and science always, always agree. So if the Bible says we're just one race, the human race, then science must also say that we're one race, the human race. Let's find out. So, but before we get to science, one more thing. In case there's still a skeptic in here who says, well, the people back in biblical times, okay, they didn't travel much, didn't have airplanes, didn't have internet, you know, they were just too in their own region. All they knew were their own people. They didn't know about people of different races because they couldn't travel and they couldn't see images like we do today. These biblical stories took place in the Middle East. You know why they call it the Middle East? Because it's right in the, how about that? Right in the middle of Africa and Europe and Asia. It is right in the middle of all three. Think about the people who live in these continents. So if you wanted to travel from Africa to Asia, you had to go through the what? The Middle East. If you want to go from Asia to Africa, you had to go through the Middle East. Unless you want to go across the sea and you want to go by land, if you want to go from Africa to Europe, you had to go through the what? Vice versa, Europe to Africa, Middle East. Of course they knew about people from different parts because everybody traveled through there. You have the story of the Ethiopian eunuch, for instance. He was from Ethiopia. Very dark-skinned people live in Ethiopia. Paul led him to Christ. He took the gospel back to Ethiopia. You had Magi from the east, you know, from modern-day Iran, Persia, maybe further east than that. He even had a guy who in Acts was called Niger. And that's not a bad word. There's a country in Africa by that same name today. Niger just means black. It was a descriptor to describe that Simeon versus other Simeons. Back in those times, we didn't use last names. We talked about, you know, so-and-so, the son of somebody, right? So or what their job was or where they were from, right? Saul of Tarsus, right? Or Lydia, the one who made purple, right? We would talk about their occupation, where they were from, whose son they were. And this is just a descriptor. You know, Simeon, that guy, who's Simeon the potter? No. Simeon of Jerusalem? No, not that Simeon. Simeon, the one we call Niger. Oh, yeah, him. I know him. The dark one, right? That they would use terms like that to describe people. I just use this as evidence to show that, of course, they knew about different skin tones. They talk about that in the scriptures in several places, but never, ever, ever does God categorize people in these different boxes that we have put them in. They're always in the human race, and the descriptors are just that. They're descriptors, right? They're either light-skinned or dark-skinned, but those are just descriptors. They don't put them in a different category. They're humans. Okay, Middle East, middle of it all, so of course they knew about other people. Now, Bible says that. What does science say? Well, there was a big old project they did a while ago called the Human Genome Project, and it was big. This was not a scientific experiment they did in a laboratory over a course of a couple of days. This took years to do this experiment. It wasn't just two or three scientists. There were dozens of scientists, all very smart, all very well adept at what they did from different countries. So different countries, different universities, different research labs, coming together and doing the Human Genome Project. And they discovered a lot of good things in doing that. The reason why we can do Ancestry.com and 23andMe today partly is because of this project. So they did a lot of research that figured out a lot of things about the stuff inside of us that makes us who we are, right? Where we come from, our genetics. So what they find out, and by the way, these are not all Bible-believing scientists. Big enough group, I'm sure some of them were, but most of the, in fact, I know some of them are, but most of these scientists, I think it's safe to say, are not Bible-reading, Bible-believing Christians. For those who do read it, you know, they certainly don't take Genesis literally like I do, for instance. So these are not people who are necessarily friendly toward the scriptures. But here's what they found out. Quote, there is no scientific evidence to support substantial differences between people groups. And the tremendous burden of proof goes to anyone who wants to assert those differences. Quote from one of the scientists in this project. Let me put that in layman's terms. What he was saying is, if you want to say that there are different people groups, if you want to say there are different races, you got to prove it. Because the evidence we found does not show that. That's what he's saying right there. Okay, another quote, a little more clear, probably this one. Quote, if you ask what percentage of your genes is reflected in your external appearance, that is what your skin tone is, right? Your external appearance. If you want to ask that question, the basis by which we talk about race, the answer, what do you think the percentage is? What is it? Someone said 10, someone said 0. The one who said 0 is the closest. 0.01%. In other words, 99.99% of you doesn't affect the way your skin tone is. 0.01% does. These are scientists, you know, masters and doctors in biology and so in genetics and so forth. Here's another quote. Dr. J. Craig Venter, I like this quote the best, head of the Celera Genomics Corp and scientists along with him at the National Institutes for Health, announced in 2000, remember that year, 2000, that they had put together a draft of the entire sequence of the human genome. This was no small project, okay? This is like a huge deal. And the researchers had unanimously declared, there were no dissenters here, dozens of scientists, different parts of the world, different labs, unanimously, most of them probably not Christians, unanimously declared, here it is, what did they declare? There's one race, the human race. That's it. Now, what year did they figure that out? It did take him a while, didn't it? I'm like, this book was completed 2,000 years ago. See, the Bible and science always agree. The difference is sometimes science is a little bit slow in catching up. You know, we could have saved these guys a lot of time. Now, I don't besmirch the work. They did a great job. You know, we found out and they found out very important information. So I'm glad they did the research. But I'm especially glad they did it because it helps people see, once again, that the Bible and science always agree. And if you trust God from the beginning, you can save yourself some trouble. But that's what they figured out 21 years ago. Now, who reported this? I know this is in their archives because I downloaded it, okay? I know they still know this at the New York Times. I know the media still knows this. Hello? Do the current, I'm going to use this term loosely, news stories reflect this knowledge? Think about the stuff they're saying to us. Now listen, if there's one race, the human race, the Bible says it, science has confirmed it, no surprise, the media seems to know it, they reported it. If there's one race, the human race, then the next time we hear a story that says, white police officer, stop! Not only is the first sentence wrong, the first word is wrong. They should just say what? Police officer, thank you. The next time we hear something about black man, stop! The first word is wrong. It should just say a man, right? A man. The next time we hear something about Black Lives Matter, stop! Exactly. Human lives matter. That's what they should say. Now, there it is. Don't get me going on the media. So, the Bible says there's one race, the human race. Science says there's one race, the human race. What do we do about it? Okay, the media is not helping us out here. So you and I, believers, what are we supposed to do about this? Practically speaking, we know this. We can solve a lot of problems if we implement this. So how do we do it? First thing we need to do is change our minds. Okay, which is hard to do because the message we have gotten for me all of my life and for probably you all of your life, the message we've been getting over and over and over and over and over and over and over again is that there are different races. White this, black this, minority that, the other thing, discrimination here, racism there. We keep hearing it again and again and again and again and again. So it's hard to change the mind. But once we change our minds, we start seeing people differently. So let me ask, has your mind changed? It sounds like you're in agreement with what I'm saying. So look at this picture, these five very different looking people, different hair color, different eye color, different skin tone. Do you believe that all these people belong to the same race? Good. That's the first step. The mind change, right? Every human being who's ever lived from Adam and Eve on is a member of the human race. Mind change starts first. After we change our minds, then what I've noticed is vocabulary starts to change. Once we change our minds, we then start changing our words. Here's an example. One of these women is African American. That is a true statement. Can you tell which one is? Of course you can't. By looking at them, you could only tell if you knew them and knew a little bit about their stories. The one on the left is my wife. She was born and raised in Florida. She is not an African American. The one on her right is her friend, a fellow geologist that she met at the university. However, her friend was born in the nation of South Africa. She migrated to the United States, got her geology degree, became a United States citizen. She's still living here today. So she has African citizenship. She has American citizenship. She is truly, by definition of the word, an African American. And she's paler than almost anybody in this room. You see how ridiculous some of these terms are that we use for people? Most people running around saying they're African Americans have never been to Africa. Let alone can they claim dual citizenship. And I see people with black hair. I see people with black pupils. I don't really see anybody with black skin. And let me tell you something. If I ever saw somebody with white skin, I'd call 911. Because they'd be close to dead. But these terms we use, even the fancy Latin terms, Caucasoid, Negroid, Australoid, no. People come from different parts of the world. People have different nationalities. You might be Italian, you might be German, you might be Irish, you might be Nigerian, fine. But you're part of one human race. Those are nationalities. You're one race. That's a different thing. So once my mind changed on this, I started changing my words. Now, this actually, the thing that really got me started on this was back when my firstborn son was 4 years old, and he was telling me a story. He started to tell me a story about a lady that we saw, and he said, Daddy, remember that, and he was 4 years old, Daddy, remember that lady with brown skin who we saw, blah, blah, blah? And I was about to correct him. I'll put that word in quotes. I was about to correct him and say, oh, no, son, we don't call those people with brown skin. We call them, and I stopped. Like, wait a minute. He's four. He knows his colors. He knows black versus brown. He knows the difference. If I tell him what I thought I was supposed to tell him, the thing that I'd been saying all that time, I would actually be teaching him wrong. He knew brown. He was right. This lady was brown, not black. And more importantly, when I really thought about it later, so I stopped. I didn't correct him. I'm glad I did. I just let him talk. I thought about it later. I thought, you know what? Not only was he right about the color, he was right about the order. He didn't say that black person. He said that person. And then he gave a descriptor. You see the difference? It's subtle, but do you see it? He said that person with brown skin. He could have said that person with a blue shirt. He could have said that person who rode a motorcycle. Those are just descriptors. But the main point is that they are a person. See now, so as I start, so, you know, months later, when years, whenever it was, when I was thinking about this, I'm like, you know what? The four-year-old had it figured out. What's wrong with me? I had the wrong descriptor. I had the wrong color. I'm like, I'm so glad I didn't correct him. She was a person with brown skin. It's just, you know, okay? That, he gets it. So that's what really started troubling me, is that, you know, we are using the wrong terms in our society. So I don't call people black. I try not to call people white or Caucasian or African American or anything like that, because I think it's a false delineation. I think we're putting people in boxes that God never put there. So I'm trying to change my language. All right. Oh, the U.S. Census. How lovely. So last year, as you did, I got my census form, and here's what it said: Person one's race. And look at the other, they're mixing white with nationality. So I guess if you're German, that means you must be white. Italian, you must also be white. I guess everybody in these countries is so-called black. Okay, so there. First of all, it's not even a good question. It's a mixed-up question. And I'm like, you know what? No, I've had enough of this. So I went to the bottom of the form, and I went to the other category. I'm glad you like that. And I sent it in. That's my census form. And 3 weeks later, I got a phone call. Early Earth Educators, this is Brian. How can I help you? Yes, this is the United States Census Bureau. I knew what this was about. Yes, how can I help you? As if I didn't know. We have a question about your census form, sir. And I'll be honest with you, I was scared, okay? So I took a breath, girded, you know, rolled up my sleeves. I'm like, nope, I'm not going to cave in. What I wrote is biblical. What I wrote is scientifically backed. I refuse to let the United States government or anybody else put me in a box that God never put me in. I'm not going to check the box they want me to check. Nope. I'm taking a stand. I'm a member of the human race. They should not even be asking that question. I'm not going to back down, come what may. So I said, yes, what is your question? We'd like to know what the residence of your youngest son, sir. Okay, we have 9 kids. Most of them are grown. The youngest is still at home, so I explain. He's still living at this address. Okay, get the little stuff out of the way. Now, what was your real question? Now, that was our only question, sir. Thank you very much. You have a nice day. Goodbye. She was looking at that form when she talked to me. They didn't even care. They didn't care that I put human race on there. So guess what I'm going to do in 2030? And I hope you do the same. And I hope a movement begins. And I hope everybody starts putting human race on there so they stop asking these unnecessary, divisive, stupid questions. Because you're all members of the same race. Everybody in the country is. 330 million Americans, all one race. It's that simple. So we change our words, we change our actions. This is an example of changing the action. I don't mark white on boxes anymore. They might tell me to, but I'm not going to. Ben Carson said, "We, the American people, are not each other's enemies. The enemies are those people behind the curtain, jerking everybody's chains and trying to divide us up by age, by race, by income." I believe he's right. It's sad to say. It's sad to say, but there are people out there, evil people, who benefit from you and I being at odds with one another. Instead of just reporting the news, there are sadly people in the news who want us to click on their story so badly, or tune into their story so badly, or buy a subscription so badly, that they will report stuff or even make up stuff that simply is not true, just to get the viewership, just to get the readers, just to get the people to gobble it up and react to it. And sad to say, but there are people out there who benefit from tension, who benefit from riots, who benefit from the ugly, nasty stuff that goes on out there. There are wicked people out there who benefit from that. He's right. And I think as a man of God, he would also agree that ultimately behind all of that, maybe underneath all of that, there's a bigger enemy, and that is the enemy of our souls. The devil wants us divided. He wants us angry. He wants us bitter. He wants us resentful. He wants us at each other's throats. He certainly doesn't want unity. Jesus Christ came to do just the opposite of that. He came to bring unity. Think about what the church is. It's not a building. The church is the body of believers. A body has to be united to function, or it's going to die. We are members of one body. We're one human race, and if you're in Christ, there's even deeper unity than that. You're not just one race. You're one body. Jesus Christ as the head, and you and everybody else members of it. And I think we have a responsibility, church, as the Church of Jesus Christ, to show people in the world what unity is. Because it's attractive. They want it. People need that. The enemy does not want us to have it. And I think this whole thing about categorizing people into different races, I don't see it in Scripture. I don't see it in science. It's, at the very least, it's of human origin. I think it might be of a more sinister origin than that. I think it might be the devil himself who wants us dividing ourselves by these artificial categories that we made up. So I don't talk that way anymore. I try to always talk about people as being people. I'll use descriptors, but now, that slavery. It's when you talk about race, you kind of got to talk about slavery, because so many people out there get it wrong, or deliberately get it wrong, or simply don't know history. And so there's a lot of misinformation about slavery. So let's talk for a moment about slavery. Slavery has taken place around the globe, every continent, most countries, for thousands of years. Thousands of years before there was ever a United States of America, there was slavery. In this continent, there was slavery. Aztec tribes conquered other tribes and enslaved them, for example. Mongols over in Asia enslaved Chinese. Europeans, Vikings came down and enslaved other people that were in Europe. You had African tribes warring against other African tribes, killing or enslaving those that they conquered. This took place, go back to Genesis. What happened to Joseph? Thrown in the well, his own brothers sold him into slavery to Ishmaelite slave traders who took him down to Egypt. He got freed, of course, but then a couple generations later, all the Israelis were enslaved by the Egyptians. So you have Middle Easterners being enslaved by Africans, Africans being enslaved by other Africans. Of course, more recently in history, Europeans went down and enslaved Africans. After that, African pirates on the Barbary Coast enslaved European sailors. I mean, you have slavery going back and forth everywhere across the globe. That was the norm for thousands of years. But it changed. Who ended slavery? Because this just happened. We had large groups of people, you had slaves. That's just the way it was. That's not the case now. Why? Do you know why? Slavery started to come to an end when one man, by the name of William Wilberforce, not a Christian initially, got elected to Parliament, smart guy. He was in British Parliament for 5 years before he became a Christian. Went on a long sailing trip with a guy who we met on this ship who was an Anglican clergyman. This guy was a pastor, and he was a scientist. And Wilberforce, smart guy, was impressed that a clergyman, a Christian guy, would actually be smart. Like, what, science? I'm intrigued. Let me know more. And so they're talking together, studying together, and pretty soon this Christian scientist leads Wilberforce to Christ. Wilberforce accepts Jesus as Savior. Years later, he's convicted, you know, this is wrong. What's going on in society is wrong. I'm a member of Parliament. I need to do something about it. So he began the movement, and some other Christians got behind him. Small group of Christians, pretty small, pushed to abolish the slave trade. Now remember, this is going on for hundreds of years, thousands of years. And they started a movement. Let's abolish slavery. It's not right. It's not biblical. It's for freedom that Christ has set us free. Let us not be bound again to a yoke of slavery. The Bible says it. Let's get this done. Wilberforce got death threats, and he pushed through. And eventually, in 1807, it took him about 20 years to fight this in the Parliament before he actually got it passed. The Slave Trade Act of 1807 was passed, and slavery and the trade and the trading of slaves was abolished once and for all in the British Empire. It started a movement, caught on in other countries, other places started doing this now, right? Eventually our country did it about 60 years later, less than 60 years later. Here's the thing. Slaves that were still, I love this part of it. Slaves that were still in chains were not yet free. They were not yet emancipated. He fought for that too. The slave trade is gone, but there are still people in chains. He kept fighting. 3 days before he died, every single slave in the British Empire was set free. One man. And the Christians who supported him ended slavery once and for all and forever in the British Empire, and it caught on and it went around the world. You know why slavery ended? Because Christians stood on the Word of God and said, enough is enough. I don't care if everybody else is doing it. I don't care if it's normal. I don't care how many people fight against me. I don't care how many death threats I get. I'm going to stand on the Word of God and do what's right, come what may. And that's how we changed the world. We have a big problem in this country with people not knowing the truth about race. If we, church, change our minds and view everybody as one race, and if we change our words, therefore, and talk about people that way, as if they're part of my race, one race, the human race, then we'll change our actions, like Wilberforce did. We'll change our interactions, and once we change our interactions, I think we can once again change the world. What do you think? So I promised you that I was going to give you the simple one-sentence solution to all racial tension. Here it is. Why don't you say it after me? There is one race. The human race. So every person I meet is a member of my race. If you believe that, is racism even possible? Only if you hated everybody, including yourself. You literally cannot have racism once you know the truth. One race, the human race, and I belong to it, which means I'm part of your race. I can't be a racist. You see, that is actually, the answer is one sentence. One sentence. All this dribble in the media about this and that and the other thing can be solved with one sentence. A mindset change, a word change, and then an action change. That's it. That's what we as believers need to spearhead in our messed up, broken society. Now, I think that's a great way to introduce people to Jesus, too, by the way. It's people want unity. I mean, that there's a ton of disunity, and when people hear a message of unity that resonates with their spirits, I mean, I knew a guy who was for 50 years just embedded in this mindset of one race against another. He was antagonistic toward people of different race. I talked to him for less than 10 minutes. I gave him this message, boiled it down to 10 minutes or less. And at the end of it, he said, that makes sense. You, because he thought he was a different race than me. He said, you're right, Brian, we're the same race. Thank you. It really was not that hard. We can actually use this as a witnessing tool. Now, unfortunately, not everybody else is there yet. So probably some people are going to say things to you that are not true. They might not call you racial epithets necessarily, but they'll probably say or insinuate things about you and the race that you supposedly belong to, and they might say things like this. They might say things like, you know, you're a victim. You're a victim because of what that other race did to your people years ago. You should be angry about that. You should be resentful about that. Frankly, you're owed something because of what that other race did to you. You should be upset. You're a victim. You'll always be a victim. If somebody says that to you or implies that, here's what I hope you say to them. You know, you and I have something in common. We're both part of the same race, the human race. And our first ancestor, Adam, he sinned. And because he sinned, he brought sin into the entire human race. And so in a sense, yeah, I was a victim of sin. That's true. But then the second Adam came. And then that second Adam took every single one of my sins, past, present, and future, and he put them on the cross. And thanks be to Jesus, the second Adam, I am no longer a victim. I have the victory. And then you could say to them, would you like to have that too? And then for most of us in this room, I'm just guessing, probably you might not be given the insinuation of being a victim. You might be given another one. You might be told that you are guilty. You're guilty because of what your race has done to another race, because of what your ancestors of your race did to the ancestors of another race. You're guilty. You should feel bad. You should put your head down. You should be sorrowful. You should be shamed. You owe them something. You're guilty. If they say that to you, I hope you say to them, you know, you and I have something in common. You and I are members of the same human race. We have the same first ancestor. His name is Adam. And because he brought sin into the human race, you're right. I was guilty. I was guilty of thousands upon thousands of sins. But then came the second Adam. And he took every one of those sins, past, present, future, nailed them to the cross. And though I was guilty, I'm no longer guilty. I am guilt-free. Would you like to be guilt-free too? I can tell you how. I hope you use those accusations, because you know they're unbiblical. I hope you use those as an avenue to get that misguided person into the kingdom of God. Use the message of race to steer them into the truth. Now, you were made in the image of Almighty God. You and every other single human being, you did not evolve from animals. You were made distinct. Adam was made distinct from all other creatures on the same day, one day of creation. Chimpanzees were made and Adam was made, separate on the same day. You do not descend from apes. We have lots of resources about that, by the way, if you want some. You were descended, actually, not just first from Adam, but if you read Luke chapter 3, it says this has a backwards genealogy. It goes the son of Seth, the son of Adam, the son of God. Your lineage actually goes one step back before Adam. It goes to God. You are descended from that line. God said, let us make mankind in whose image? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, right there, in our image, after our likeness. That's your lineage. That's where you come from. And because Adam and then we after him messed things up with our sin, God sent the atoning sacrifice for our sins. God said, I don't want these people separate from me forever. They're mine. They're my children. They're made in my image. I want them for eternity. They can't save themselves. They're too sinful, but I will save them because I will send my perfect son to take their place and take their sins. We are guilt-free. We have the victory in Jesus if we accept that free gift of salvation from him. A lot of condemnation out in our world today. A lot of people throwing insults and accusations and condemnations. That's from the devil. That's not from God. God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world should be saved through him. If you're feeling badly about your sins, that's not condemnation, that's conviction of the Holy Spirit. He is telling you he wants you to come into the family of God. He says, I will take those sins from you, no more guilt, no more victim status. You get to be in the family of God if you accept that free gift of salvation through Jesus. If you want to do that, it's easy. It's ABC easy. You can do it right now, in fact. If you've not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you can do it right now with me. You can talk to Pastor afterward or anybody else in this, me or anybody else in here afterward who would be happy to lead you into a life-saving, eternal relationship with him. It's ABC easy. In fact, maybe we should pray this together. Well, let's just make sure we're on the same page. I'm a sinner. Anybody in here a sinner besides me? Okay, I'm in great company. Good. Yep. So I am a sinner. I have to admit that, letter A. B, I have to believe that Jesus died for those sins. C, I have to confess those sins to him and then commit my life to him. It's ABC easy, admit, believe, and confess. So if you'd like to do that, that will get you into the kingdom of God and you'll be just as saved as your pastor here is. So if you don't mind me leading you in a prayer, I'll do that. It says if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. So let's confess that. If you've already done this before, let's do it again out loud. And then anybody who wants to do it for the first time can join us, and they won't stand out of the crowd that way. Does that sound good? All right, why don't you pray after me then, everybody. Say, Heavenly Father, I admit to you that I'm a sinner. And I believe that Jesus died for my sins. I confess to you my sins. I'm sorry for my sins. And I pray that you will help me to live my life for you. And I want to commit my life to you today. And I thank you so much for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that, you're saved. Yeah. That's awesome. That is awesome. So if you know anybody who needs information like this, information about there being one race, the human race. Frankly, most people I talk to need that information. If you need information on dinosaurs, how they fit into a 6,000-year-old Earth, or how we really did not evolve from apes, and how the science shows that. Okay, evolution is very unscientific. It's definitely just a belief system. It's not science. Or carbon dating or anything like that. We have lots of resources back there. If you know somebody who likes to read fun fantasy fiction books, but they don't necessarily want to read, you know, people who might not come to a church, but might not go to an event like this, might not even pick up the Bible, but they would pick up Harry Potter. Well, I write books like that, but they're better than Harry Potter. They actually show, thank you, a lot better, I think, because they show people that the Bible and science agree. So if you as a believer want to see more ways in which the Bible and science agree, but you want to read something that's kind of fun and not technical, my books are good for believers. They're also good for skeptics. Like I just said, people who like to read fun adventure fantasies, but, you know, they might not read the Bible or a technical resource to give them, but they would read something fun. I write with those people in mind, and I'm really kind of disgusted by the stuff that teenagers are reading. A lot of wicked stuff out there that's sold as just fun fantasy fiction, but it teaches kids that sorcery is good, that witchcraft is okay, that vampires and whatnot. It's just there's a lot of really wicked stuff out there. Some of it subtle, some not too subtle. And teenagers and others, I'm especially concerned about kids, but kids and adults are gobbling it up. And so my books are hopefully a counterweight to that. So we have those, but we also have, you buy two books, you get a DVD for free. Our best value is actually the mega pack, though. You can get a bunch of resources. Literally, we've actually added to it since this picture was taken, so there's more in the mega pack than you see right here. It's not a $115 value, it's a $135 value. All for $79. So you get 35 resources, and it's on the back table there in that green bag. If you have somebody who needs this information in your family, or friends of yours who you think would watch a DVD or read a small booklet on something, we have those things for you. Stop by the table. We also have a buy three get one free deal with our $5 items, and we even have a dollar basket. There's even a Dollar Tree back there for you if you want. If you just want to buy a We just want to buy a couple small things. We're not trying to break the bank here. We're trying to equip people. We want you to have the resources to go forward and show people how the Bible and science agree in all these different topics: evolution, carbon dating, all age of the universe, all this stuff. So we have that. And even if you don't want to buy anything, I still want to give you something. I will give you a free brochure if you will tell me just one thing. But first of all, this picture right here, these girls, these are twins. No kidding, that's not a Photoshop. These beautiful ladies are twins, same mama, same daddy, same womb at the same time. How can that be? Well, we have an amazing creator, don't we? They're part of the same human race, okay? There are not different races out there. And if you would come back to my table, I'll be back there in just a minute, and if you will tell me the simple one-sentence solution to all racial tension, I will give you a free brochure about the twins. It's called Two-Tone Twins. How can that be? And I'll give that to you for free, no catch, if you'll just tell me this. Ready? Here's your review for the quiz. Say it after me. There's only one race. The human race. So every person I meet is a member of my race. Remember, the Bible and science always agree. We're early earth educators. Thank you so much. You have a blessed day.
Hallelujah. Why don't you stand to your feet today? Wasn't that fantastic?
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Today after we pray, you have three places to go. You got to go to his table, get some resources, go back in the back room, sign up for the auction, buy something, and also pick up your children. Don't leave your children here. These three things are so, so important, okay? Father God, we just praise you today, God. We thank you, God, for that message. I pray, dear God, that from this day forth, when we leave here, we will leave part of the human race. Not a race determined by the color of our skin tone, but one family of believers under God, the human race, sharing this truth to many who've been fed alive. God bless your people today. May this be the beginning of the rest of our lives. May we take this new narrative that's really the foundation narrative of your word, God, and may we live the rest of our lives seeking harmony, seeking unity, God. Seeking to be one human race, God, under God. Bless your people today, God. May they leave here, God, encouraged today. May they come back at that appointed hour. And we give you all the praise, glory, and thanks for the service. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Remember, go see Brian Norman at the at the. At